Thank you, everybody, for joining us for Summer Forum this Sunday, and we are very excited to have you all with us and to be joined by Erin Mendenhall, the mayor of Salt Lake City, who is our guest today. Before we get going on this week's Summer Forum, though, an important and sad announcement that we need to make. Harold Strawn, who was a very, very dear member of both our congregation and our church's staff for many, many years, and who, in particular for what we're doing today, which is Summer Forum, he was in charge of coordinating Summer Forum for many, many years. And he passed away this last, very, very recently. So wanted to announce that and express, how sorry we are to, his family and those who knew him, including many, many of us here today, and how grateful we are for his life and for his involvement in our church and in Summer Forum over many, many years. So we will inform the congregation of things like a memorial service and events like that as those plans shape up, but wanted to announce that Harold Strawn has passed away, and that we're very sad for his loss and for his friends and family, and very grateful for all the years that he had and for his work and time with us here at First Unitarian Church. So thank you, Harold. All right. Our guest today is the mayor of Salt Lake City, a big get that we are very excited to have her with us and joining us for Summer Forum this morning. And I am going to pass over the proverbial mic, if you will, to Don Walton, who will be our master of ceremonies for Summer Forum today and who will further introduce our speaker. Thank you very much. And Don, the floor is yours.
Okay, thanks, Dylan. Our guest speaker this morning is Mayor Erin Mendenhall. This is the mayor's second visit to Summer Forum. The last time was in 2019, just before she was elected. She became mayor after 6 years on the city council, and the last year she served as chair of the city council. Major theme of her career and as mayor has been a drive for clean air. In 2010, she co-founded a nonprofit organization called Breathe Utah. The mayor has a bachelor's in gender studies and a master's in science and technology from the U. She and her husband, Kyle, have 3 children. This morning, she'll be talking to us on clean energy and homeless outreach. Mayor, welcome to Summer Forum again.
Thank you. Thank you for having me. And it's great to be here with you all today. I see a lot of friends in the participants list and some of your faces. The last time I was here actually with you was to join you in celebrating our friend Vicky Chavez, and what an incredible day that was for an amazing woman, really, and her perseverance. And it was a culmination of all of your efforts that I think First Unitarian is very well known for. You're good at supporting one another, and the sacrifice and the commitment of your community to provide such a loving sanctuary to Vicky and her children is a testament to your goodness and your commitment to justice. And it's really a wonderful thing to behold and be able to experience by visiting with you today. But as the mayor, I'm grateful that you are an integral part of Salt Lake City. You're a key part of who we are as a community, and you embody that. But my very first interaction with First Unitarian wasn't in the building. but it was outside of the former federal courthouse where Joan was helping us chant and sing in protest of the trial of Tim DeChristopher. And that was my first engagement. I had a 3 or 4 year old at my knee and a baby on my hip, and we spent days out there. And I remember it was very cold, but singing warmed us. And for the, I think from that bookend to all that we've been through since then as a broader community and the experiences I've had with First Unitarian, also as a CCNS parent for all three of my kids' time in preschool, the rest of my days, when I think about First Unitarian, I will think of the incredible compassion and dedication to what's right and support for your community. And I think this forum that you put on is a good representation of the congregation's appreciation for lifelong learning and community involvement. And I've looked over the summer forum topics, I think, which also underscore that you're a group that cares about real issues, about equity, about protecting our environment, and about justice. And those are all things we need more of today. Discourse, learning, discussion, ideas, challenging ideas. So invitations like this don't often come my way from congregations. Different kinds of speaking engagements do, but I am happy to be with you this morning and to be included and invited to share some of the clean energy progress that we're making as a city and to talk about our outreach efforts with our unhoused residents. And as Don mentioned, and I'm an environmentalist at my core, and clean energy has been at the top of both my personal and my professional priorities for a long time. My passion and my concern about our valley's air quality drove me into public service about 15 years ago, just as an activist and as a volunteer. And I've told you this story before, but it was really when I learned that our inversions and other bad air quality days could cumulatively take 2 years off of my then newborn son's life. I was holding him during an inversion, listening to KCPW talking about a report the legislature had just received, talking about this cumulative impact. And that's where the switch clicked for me, and I felt a responsibility to get involved. So then I joined as a volunteer Utah Moms for Clean Air, and later co-founded Breathe Utah, and transitioned from activism into more of a leadership role. I was elected to the city council in 2013, and I definitely know some of you as my former District 5 constituents. And I was appointed to the state's air quality board in 2014, where I still serve there, and I have had the honor of being your mayor just since January of 2020. So making sure every day that our city is taking concrete steps, meaningful, intentional, and strategic steps to reduce our carbon footprint and provide better renewable energy options to our residents has been a priority for Salt Lake City for over 20 years. And it's definitely a key component of my team's focus every day. The city, as you probably know, has had a standalone Department of Sustainability, which was run by Vicki Bennett until her recent retirement. Vicki is a forward-thinking, really committed leader in her own right. And a lot of the progress, much of the progress that we've made in the last 20 years was done under her direction. That team continues on, and it's led today by Debbie Lyons, who's been with the city actually for over 20 years, working with Vicki. We're in great hands with Debbie. And that department's responsible for researching and implementing all of our big clean energy projects. But they also lead other really important work like our recycling and our composting programs. And they're working right now on resident food equity. So they've convened a panel of food equity advisors of residents who have been challenged with food security, and we're helping to map that out. So when I first took office as mayor, I challenged every one of our departments to insert the lens of sustainability into every decision that they make, whether that's construction or our vehicle purchases for our fleet, office supplies, do we need to print as much as we do? We take it all very seriously, and I don't just want sustainability to be thinking about green. I want every employee and every department to recognize their environmental impact through the decisions that we make. And one of our biggest steps forward on clean energy started just last year in 2020. And because of 2020, I don't think we tooted the horn very loud to let the city know what an incredible thing happened. It was the legislation that passed after we'd worked very hard with a number of other communities and Rocky Mountain Power to enable the community renewable energy program. And I want to invite you to stick with me through a little bit of wonky policy nerd work for just a second, because this is a phenomenal first of its kind in the nation program. And it is the path for us to 100% clean renewable energy for all of Salt Lake City. This is how we're gonna do it. It started in 2019 when Salt Lake City adopted a joint resolution. That means the mayor and the city council agreed that we wanted to shift to net 100 clean electricity for the entire community. And to achieve this, we joined together with 22 other cities who share that clean energy goal and formed the Utah 100 Communities Coalition. So together we're moving with 22 other communities to take steps with our shared power utility, Rocky Mountain Power, to become a net 100 renewable electricity community. These efforts that we're undertaking right now, I'd love, actually, Joan, if you could put the first slide up, it will help me tell you the timeline of what's happening here quickly. I'm a visual learner, so I hope this might help with for you as well. I just signed Salt Lake City's governance agreement that says, yes, we are committed to this process that has been laid out now in state statute. And we have 22 other cities and some are counties who are signing those agreements as well. This kicks off a process where we come together as a board and design what the rate of the program will be. And there's a mandate actually that I'll talk about in a moment that it be affordable, that it be equitable in its ability to not only serve our residents, but to not impact our low income customers. So we're designing that program right now jointly, and we'll be obviously projecting what those impacts will be, how could we mitigate those impacts as a city, and how would the other cities do it, because we can't do it differently. Part of the requisite of this program is that there be one program for everyone. Not Salt Lake City's gonna have a different rate and subsidize here, and these people are not gonna subsidize. It has to be the same across the board. So that planning process is underway right now. And in January, we should have that ready to go. And then September of next year is when the Utah Public Service Commission will review that proposal and hopefully approve it. I would love to ask your support if you're interested in following along with this process and supporting the application as a member of the public when it goes to the Public Service Commission. And then the legislation lays out that December of next year will be when we can finalize that entire agreement. It will be set and we can go out for a request for proposals to build this program. It could be solar, geothermal, it could be any number of renewable combinations. And we're gonna go out to bid with Rocky Mountain Power and ask developers of renewable energy to give us their best option. And that will happen just after that December 22 finalization. So we can go out to bid in early 2023. Joan, you can take that down now. Thank you so much. So wind, solar power, geothermal, and it would be for use by all Salt Lake City households, all businesses, and any other organization to help us achieve our climate positive goals. The Community Renewable Energy Program has the potential to drive more renewable energy development than any other option that we've ever been familiar with. So unlike solar on homes and businesses, the Community Renewable Energy Program won't require any upfront customer investment or financing. Unlike our Blue Sky program, these program resources are going to interconnect and with they will interconnect with and feed electricity directly into the Rocky Mountain Power electric system. And unlike subscriber solar, which really has a finite number of blocks available, the Community Renewable Energy Program will scale up to serve all participating customers in all of these communities across the state. So depending on how many customers decide to participate, and by the way, it would be an opt-out, not an opt-in, as all of the renewable energy programs currently are, it's reasonable for us to expect that the Community Renewable Energy Program could double the amount of utility scale solar in Utah by 2030. And that would transform 37% of all the power Rocky Mountain Power provides in Utah to renewable energy. It's a phenomenal transformation. And we want the program to be the default, not an opt-in, as I said, like every other existing program. And to do that, we have to make it equitably affordable and protect our low-income customers. So state law actually requires that we submit a plan for low-income assistance for Salt Lake City. And that means if the program rate is higher than the standard rate offer, we want to be able to protect our most vulnerable residents. So that work is happening now. And if anyone is hungry to be involved and interested, please do reach out to me or my office and let us know. And there are subcommittees working on this right now, stakeholder groups from across the city. So it will be the first of its kind in the nation. And for the sake of our climate, it triples the positive impact that Salt Lake City could have made on our own. And what I mean by that is we're just a small fraction of the total demand that these 22 communities are creating by coming together. So last year, I started with the big pipeline to 100% renewable energy, but there are many other things that we're simultaneously working on. And last year we completed another 2020 quiet thing that we I'm happy to tell you about today, but we could have talked about it last year if we weren't so busy with other things. We completed the largest single renewable energy acquisition in the city's history. It is the biggest solar project that we've ever done. And initially, the city was focused on ensuring that our internal municipal operations were powered by clean energy. So that means all of the city's libraries, all of our other buildings, public utility buildings, City Hall. We're looking at just the energy we consume as Salt Lake City Corporation. But that goal, I think, quickly and really appropriately grew to encompass the entire city, our residents, our businesses, and government alike. So the city set that ambitious goal just a couple of years ago of 2030 to achieve net 100% renewable energy for the entire community. But we're working hard to try to get there even sooner. And before that, we began working on our municipal electricity goal, as I mentioned. We established that in 2016, and the goal was to have 50% renewable by 2020 and 100% by 2030. So I'm really happy to report that late last year, our state regulators approved an 80 megawatt project, and it's known as the Electron Solar Project. And if you could put up the second slide, Joan, 80 megawatts might sound kind of meaningless, so I want to put it into perspective. So Salt Lake City uses 113 gigawatt hours in 2019, that was our metered electric consumption. And you can see that our distributed solar panels that we have on buildings, they make up for about 3% of that need. Our subscriber solar program, which probably some of you are even a part of, only covers about 6% of our total need, but Electron is going to cover 88%. It's gonna basically close the gap almost completely for us. It's a tremendous, giant project. And we partnered with five other big organizations and Rocky Mountain Power to develop this massive solar farm that's about to break ground out in Tooele County. And those partners were Park City, Summit County, Utah Valley University, Deer Valley, and Park City Mountain Resort. It should be complete by 2023. And the great news is that this is a very affordable project. The price of this electricity is well within what we already budget for our municipal electricity use, and it's actually less than a 2% difference from what we budgeted before it. So we will be purchasing the equivalent of 90% of what we used in 2019. Our sustainability team is also working right now on the final steps of a bulk solar purchase program. Soon we're going to go out to bid to select a solar panel installer that you as residents could be able to contract with at a discounted purchase price for rooftop solar panels and installation. So this hopefully having a vetted company would take a lot of the guesswork out of solar residential solar process for you as our residents. And we're just about to finish that process up. So if you're interested in solar on your home, the city is working to help make that more affordable and also make sure that you have a reliable contractor to do it with. And as focused as we are on converting our energy sources to clean options, Salt Lake City is also at the same time really focused on smaller efforts like helping constituents convert some of the household items and appliances to cleaner versions. And this spring in 21, we made good on a promise that I've talked about for a couple of years, wanting to bring the Utah Department of Air Quality Lawnmower Exchange Program, the CARET program. And I know Representative Waite is in the room. Thank you for your support at the state level. The legislature usually funds the CARET program, but I wanted Salt Lake City to participate in a way that allowed us to focus some of those electric lawnmower opportunities on our hardest hit areas of air pollution. So Salt Lake City funded basically the 1,000 lawnmowers that could be dedicated for Salt Lake City residents. We partnered with DAQ for the distribution, and that was a $300 rebate ultimately for residents. So you could have your rebate check and go get that electric lawnmower that you want if they swapped out their gas lawnmowers for a clean electric one. And that might seem like a little thing, but gas powered lawnmowers and other yard tools like leaf blowers or snow blowers, they don't have the same emission standards as our vehicles. And running a gas powered lawnmower for 1 hour produces the equivalent air pollution as driving a gas powered car for 196 miles. 1 hour of mowing your lawn is almost the equivalent of 200 miles of driving. And the EPA estimates that lawnmowers account for 5% of our national total air pollution. That's astonishing. So this year's program and this partnership was a first for us in that we prioritized environmental equity in the distribution of the mowers. And since our West Side residents experience markedly worse air quality than other parts of the city, we made sure to dedicate a greater portion of the clean lawn mowers to those residents. So a quarter, 250 of those 1,000 mowers were set aside for residents in the zip codes that have the hardest impacts with air pollution. And now I'm gonna try to transition to the inland port. And because as we're on the west side and thinking about environmental justice issues and threats, I know that last week you learned more about the inland port and the likely environmental harm that it could inflict on our valley, particularly on Salt Lake City's west side, which already really endures inequitable air quality and many other challenges. I sincerely appreciate our community members who are so invested in this cause. And I know that their work has given lawmakers at the state level a lot to think about. From the city's perspective, we share a lot of the same concerns. And in addition to the really serious health challenges that the port poses, the process that the state took and the legislation that lawmakers adopted really jeopardize zoning and taxing authority, not only for Salt Lake City, but for all 249 Utah cities and towns. What they did to us enables them to do it to any of the other cities and towns. And I'm sure you know that the city's been involved, therefore, in a lawsuit. It's now being considered by the Utah Supreme Court, and we believe that the state's actions were unconstitutional, and we believe we have a really strong case in proving such. There's not a lot more I can say about the litigious aspects of this, given the lawsuit, but I do want you to know in no uncertain terms that I believe the port poses a myriad of threats to our community's well-being, and that's why our legal team is going to continue to fight it. On to another topic that's very much top of mind for our residents citywide, which is outreach and services to our unhoused residents. There's really no getting around the fact that far too many of our residents lack stable and safe housing. We know from a housing study that Salt Lake City did just a couple of years ago, we know that about half of our residents are renters in Salt Lake City. And of the renters, about half of that population are housing compromised, which means they're paying more than 30% of their income for their housing. And under that, those circumstances, a job loss, an accident, a breakup, health difficulties could compromise one's ability to make those rental payments. We also know that some people in who own their homes are housing compromised in terms of their income and what they pay for housing. But the issue became all the more visible and widespread due to the COVID-19 pandemic. And as a capital city, it's one of our most pressing and most complicated priorities. As the state capital, we're the nexus of services and opportunities for individuals experiencing homelessness, and we will continue to be. And we've been trying to make a difference in this space for decades, but some of our neighboring cities and counties offer next to no services for homeless individuals, and some have disallowed affordable housing through zoning. The legislature is working to insist that they do allow affordable housing, and we appreciate that. But it's really no wonder then that many people end up seeking out help in Salt Lake City, even though they may not have previously lived here. You probably know that our city has two homeless resource centers, and in recent years, we've allocated about $15 million every year toward providing homeless services. So this includes grants to service providers, emergency response, motel voucher funding, and neighborhood cleanup. We've also invested in our homeless response and engagement team, which is what we call HEART in Salt Lake City Corporation. And that team responds to community concerns across the board for housed and unhoused residents as it relates to homelessness. In 2020 and again in 2021, Salt Lake City worked with the county and homeless service providers to open an emergency winter overflow shelter in Salt Lake City. And last fall, in an effort to offer support and safety to our unhoused residents while also keeping our public spaces safe and clean, we created the Community Commitment Program. This is a focused outreach effort. Instead of asking individuals who are living on the street to come in to receive services, we worked with what ended up being about 16 different organizations to say, let's get together and go out to where these encampments are. Let's meet them where they're at. And it includes today more than a dozen service providers, the county and the city, and we're trying to address encampment concerns and the broader needs of our unsheltered neighbors. So this includes providing access to mental health and substance abuse treatment. And we hold resource fairs together with the County Health Department and the Salt Lake City Community Connection Center, which is our social workers. And legal defenders come out and the Salt Lake City Justice Court comes out. And that has been a very popular service that's offered, which is to help individuals resolve any outstanding legal issues they may have. So that our judges and attorneys come out and meet with them on the street to do that. The teams work really hard to try to connect individuals with housing opportunities, with general health needs, mental health care, I said substance abuse treatment, legal assistance, and COVID vaccinations, COVID tests. There's many offers for temporary shelter, and the resource fairs have helped many people. But an astonishing fact, as we've gone about this since last October, is that approximately 80% of the offers we make to an individual for shelter that is specific to their needs are declined. So only about 20% of people say yes. And this is after weeks of building rapport, trying to understand what their specific needs are. Do they have benefits they aren't accessing? Are there health concerns? And then there's a specific shelter offer made. So the majority of people say no. And that is troubling to me. And part of what it says to me is that we need to offer more. We need to have more diversity in the options that we're offering people. There are trust issues. There's security issues. There's mental health issues. There's substance abuse issues. And there is no silver bullet. We know that. But the work that we do and the options that we provide people need to be as individualized as those individuals themselves. So we are constantly working and looking across the country and even outside of the country at different approaches people, organizations, cities are taking to try to broaden that portfolio of options for people. The component of the community commitment program, that where we go out and meet people where they're at, involves working with the county to complete camp abatements or camp closures. Once they become so large that it's determined basically because of their size, and once they've begun to pose health and safety risks for people who are living in them and for the greater, broader public around the area, the camp abatements are completed only after residents are given notice and additional offers of services and shelter are made. So we make every effort to try to connect people with shelter. I know that some members of our community feel that the city shouldn't support these encampments, or should rather allow the encampments to stay instead of closing them. But we've made a policy decision, and I don't believe that there's a safe and compassionate way to have people camping outside in the middle of winter or in the sweltering summer heat that we've been recently experiencing. There are other solutions, and that includes emergency shelters, it includes hotel and motel vouchers, and tiny home communities, and they're worth pursuing. And I think it's incumbent upon us as a community and as a city to do better than leaving them on the street. And we are. So there are some members of the unsheltered community who, for a variety of reasons, are just not interested in the shelter options we provide. And that's why we're going to keep investing in additional and new options for people in need. Solving homelessness is about so much more than providing shelter. Homelessness is a catastrophic loss of family, a loss of community. And we must take a multifaceted approach that begins with preventing people from becoming homeless in the first place. And that is a great deal of what our investment as a city, our monetary investment, is in. But it's also about all the additional supportive services and creative housing options for those who do find themselves without housing. And I've always had a vision for a tiny home community in Salt Lake City. And in April, I was excited to announce that the city was taking a big step forward on that goal with a partnership with the Other Side Academy to create the Other Side Village, which is our tiny home community pilot. Having an operator and a manager on board was a big step to get this project starting to roll. And in the Other Side Academy, I think we have a partner that is devoted to the success and empowerment of its residents. And they've got a great track record here locally in Salt Lake City of successfully managing a peer-based community while being a real asset to the neighborhood and the city. I'll share a quick story with you. On the afternoon of the windstorm, September 18th last year, actually the morning after the May 30th protest that turned violent, and when the police car was flipped over and windows were broken and graffiti happened all over the city, both of those moments, I got a call from the other side academy, Dave DeRocher there. Hey, we're already out here with our brooms and garbage bags. We're cleaning up. You just tell us where to go. Otherwise, we're going to wander around and just clean up everything we can find. That's the kind of community partner they are. I didn't even think to call them, but they were already out there just finding ways to help. And they're a wonderful asset to our city. And I know that their devotion and their passion for success is going to carry over into their work with the Other Side Village that we're working to create. So our solutions on homelessness need to be as diverse as the challenges that our neighbors are facing. And there's no one size fits all solution for homelessness. And no one has a corner on the market of great ideas for homeless services or support to keep people in housing. So please keep talking to us, share with us your ideas, share with us great articles you read or things you see happening in other parts of the country that you think we should know about. We are hungry and we are tenacious about finding solutions. So in June, one of those solutions opened up, which was a partnership with Shelter the Homeless and The Road Home as we opened the Magnolia Apartments. They're actually starting to be occupied just this month, but we did a ribbon cutting last month. And it's a brand new building downtown in Salt Lake City. And it was constructed specifically to become a home for 65 formerly chronically homeless individuals. And all of the people who will move into this new building, into their own apartments that are fully furnished, they will have experienced chronic homelessness, and most of them will have spent at least 700 nights on the street. It's a beautiful thing, permanent supportive housing that we're working together to open another one. And the Magnolia and other developments in our city, like Palmer Court, are about so much more than four walls and a door. They have to include, and they do include, wraparound services and case management and healthcare, but most importantly, community. Building space for community and creation of relationships. So permanent supportive housing programs like this, with this wraparound support, have a 95% success rate. Can you imagine that? 95% success for people who have spent years on the street and who have likely had many other housing or shelter offers. So Palmer Court is a 201 unit apartment building, and it serves individuals and families who have experienced chronic homelessness. And in 2009, when our first residents moved in there, they had collectively spent 300 years without a home of their own, those residents. It's a wonderful thing. And if you're interested in helping with any of the furnishing needs of the residents at Magnolia, I know that the Road Home would appreciate that, and you can reach out to them if you'd like to help. There's another effort that has a direct and positive impact on our homeless community, and that's the city's Community Connection Center. It was formed several years ago when I was on the city council. And the community connection team is made up of social workers, caseworkers, who serve as liaisons between the frontline police work and the community. So the Community Connection Center serves a lot of functions, but they really do triage of an individual or a family in need of mental health support and care. They can do intermittent and short-term therapeutic intervention. So sometimes when I go in there, there's a couple social workers and they're on a phone call doing a therapy session with a client. They do case coordination between agencies, helping people to navigate the complexities of all of the bureaucracies. And that could include housing applications and navigating that housing process, helping people just get their basic needs, making sure they have their groceries and they have their medication and they're able to get to appointments they need to, and also helping people navigate the behavioral health system. So we just doubled down on this program in our last budget that was approved in June, and we're hiring an additional 6 social workers, which is getting us closer to our goal of having 24/7 social worker coverage through the police department. If the program had the capacity to scale up to 24/7, we would have done it. but we're getting there. We believe hopefully by next year, we'll be able to be at 24/7 coverage. So that if someone calls 911 and if they, oftentimes there are frequent flyers, people who call often and the dispatch knows who they are. If they have an established relationship with a case manager, if they may not be in need of police help, then they can connect with that social worker. And that should be available 24/7 because mental health needs don't follow in a 9-to-5 schedule. So that's what we're working for. And you know that Utah is the fastest growing state in the nation population-wise. And I'm sure you've all seen and experienced how intense our housing market is in Salt Lake City. But that intensity is doubly true for affordable housing. We are facing this unprecedented population growth and a rising cost of living that is accompanied by stagnant wages and a low minimum wage. And in the state of Utah, our legislature has tied the hands of cities from being able to change minimum wage. Only the state legislature can do that. And it's a real challenge for our city's workforce to find affordable apartments or homes to live in. So we've been committed to developing and maintaining affordable housing that's already existing here. And if you might think back to 2018, we raised our sales tax, and it was a process we called Funding Our Future. And we asked the community, what would you like, if we do this tax increase, what would you like us to invest in? And today, still, you can track where that money is going on a Funding Our Future dashboard that the city maintains, and you can see where the money's going. But a portion of what we dedicated is for affordable housing. So that ongoing revenue from the sales tax has put more than $64 million into affordable housing. That money translates into over 2,500 new units, affordable units, and has supported the preservation of existing affordable housing in the city. And that's, I think we have about 450 units under construction or in the pipeline just in the last about 8 months in Salt Lake City. So it's a tremendous amount of housing. The need is greater than what we were producing, but we are working very hard at this. We're also updating our city zoning codes to try to allow for more diversity in the kind of housing, the shape of the housing, the size of the housing, and for density in some parts of the cities where in the city where it makes sense. I think really what makes Salt Lake City so special, what keeps me here, is the people who live here. And we're a city of intention. We as Salt Lakers live here on purpose. It's not cheaper. It's not necessarily easier to get housing here, to maintain it. But we come here because of the community. That's why I moved here at the age of 18 from a suburb, and why I feel connected, and my heart is connected to the people here, because there's an intention about who we are as Salt Lakers. And we want this city to be a home to people across a demographic and a socioeconomic spectrum. We want people to be able to call this place home if they want to, and to afford to live wherever in the city they want to. And I think that's the duty, and it's really the beauty of local government when it's working like it should, that we take the values of our people and we intentionally intersect it with the realities of the marketplace and the environment and the infrastructure as it exists, and then we make them work better for us. We do it together for all of us. And that's for another talk on equity that I would love to have a conversation with you about. But that work is what we are all about at Salt Lake City, trying to merge the values and of you, our people, with the realities of the world as they play out in our city for the betterment of everybody. So thank you all for having me here today. And I'd be happy to take any questions or hear your stories or take any ideas you might have.
Thank you very much. Madam Mayor. That's quite an impressive job you've been doing there. I'm a little shocked at that 80% decline rate from offers to the homeless. Are there members of the homeless community on your advisory team, whatever you might have working there?
You mean the HART team, perhaps the city employed one?
Well, whatever advisory panel you might have on homeless actions you're going to take.
So the city doesn't actually, we don't convene the home advisory panel, but Shelter the Homeless does. Okay. And as you saw recently, Governor Cox has selected an individual specifically because of their lived experience to serve on that advisory board. But the city doesn't run an advisory board. We do, the HART team I was talking about are three city employees who I don't believe any of them have lived experience of being unhoused. But those advisory panels, they're called there's a local homeless coordinating committee, and there are several of those throughout the state, and that lived experience is present there.
On your shift to solar power, renewable energy, is Rocky Mountain Power actively engaged in this, or what is their approach to renewable energy?
Yes, they are a partner in all of these endeavors. It's much easier, and it's smarter for us to do it that way. Just like when we created our city's first transit master plan, which looked at where our residents would ride public transit if it were available, not where the regional commuters would, which is a traditional way of looking at where transit goes. We partnered with UTA then to do that city study because we knew ultimately that's who it was going to implement and who we'd be contracting with. So similarly, when we're looking at any of our clean energy infrastructure or programmatic desires, we work with Rocky Mountain Power. We've watched, and I visited the city of Boulder, Colorado, some years ago, probably 6 years ago now, and listened, which was probably only 4 years into their work to try to municipalize power, make this basically the city making their own power company themselves. They're 10 years into that now, and they still haven't succeeded. So it's really not a good option for cities to try to go it without their power provider.
And on that renewable energy issue, can the city require that the inland port use renewable energy, even make the port generate its own renewable energy? What kind of influence does the city have on that?
I don't believe that we have the authority, or that any city has the authority to specify power type. But when we achieve our 100% renewable energy through the community renewable energy program that I talked about, that will provide clean energy to all of the inland port that is in Salt Lake City. So it will do it anyway. And that's a big part of why this effort is so, it's revolutionizing power for Salt Lake City, but in perpetuity, and the beauty of it being in 22 other cities and towns.
So the drought is on everybody's mind and brings up that issue of converting yards into xeriscape instead of everybody watering their lawns all the time. Is the city considering ways to help bring down the cost of converting to xeriscape?
I haven't heard of work happening around that. And I suppose it's worth plugging, and I didn't mention, even though I think it's relevant on an environmental and an environmental justice level, the 1,000 trees that we're planting on the west side every year. And we've planted we're up to 1,500 now, and we'll do the next 500 in the fall for this year. When we completely remove water and any landscaping, our trees really suffer. And a long time ago with the Rip the Strip program, when people tore out sprinkling and any vegetation on those park strips, we lost thousands of trees in the city who had relied on that water, however meager it might be. So the 30% minimum vegetation is partially to maintain our urban forest Even if those trees aren't on your property, their roots may be sort of dependent upon the water that you put down. So I still support a minimum coverage of some landscaping to maintain our urban forest, but it's a good idea to look at how we could help close that financial gap for people to get down to 30% instead of 100%.
Thank you. Question on the Salt Lake City Police Department and the work to balance concerns to have more accountability and a better trained police force with ensuring our police feel appreciated, supported, and trusted by the community. For example, the recent 30% pay raise. Can you give us an update on the police department?
A great big question. So if you didn't hear, just about nearly 3 weeks ago, I announced that we are giving, we're raising the pay of our police department, but also our firefighters and AFSCME, which is the third union that we negotiate with, who represent engineers, 911 dispatch, plumbers who work for the city, technicians, people at the airport. They all encounter work that is more complicated and often more difficult than anywhere else in the state of Utah. And I believe that they should be compensated as such. And it's been, I believe, since the Corradini administration that our police have not been leading the market in the state of Utah. So we are correcting for that now. And the pay raise is more dramatic with the police because of decades of underpaying. They have dropped farther and farther from what it would mean to lead the market. The fire department is much closer, so it's less of an increase. It's 4% increase for our police or firefighters because they were closer to leading the market. Now they will lead the market. And AFSCME as well was closer, and so it took less to close that gap. But it's the right thing to do. And when it comes to accountability and the evolution of policing in general, but also at the granular level, our Commission on Racial Equity and Policing, as you probably know, have been advising Salt Lake City since August of last year. They've now issued to the council and myself two sets of recommendations. We implemented and funded the first set during the budget process, basically. And the second set includes one thing I'll mention because I think it pertains to the question, which is that there be community educators built into the training at the police department who can work with our officers to understand different communities' histories with policing, both at a broad level and within Salt Lake City. Those histories exist and they're relevant to interactions today. And that there be better cultural training from our community members to our police officers. And I think that's a fantastic recommendation that the Commission on Racial Equity and Policing made, something that we'll be working to build in and fund as well. But if you're interested in the results of their work, which is ongoing, please check out the website for Salt Lake City Commission on Racial Equity and Policing.
Okay, it is the top of the hour. We'd like to thank you again, Mayor, for stopping by and talking with us this morning.
It's a pleasure. I wish I could shake your hands and get a hug from some of you.
Yeah, well, thank you. Thank you again so much for joining us. We wish we could do that as well. And you'll really appreciate it. We know as the mayor, your schedule is tight and you are in demand. So we really appreciate you taking the time to come and talk with us this morning. And thanks again for joining us today.